All right, thanks. It was really good to have Mark up here before me, because I think that what I'm going to talk about plays into what he spoke to really well. You know, he spoke about a lot of the policies and a lot of the challenges facing the industry, and this is, I think, a pretty good case study in one of the challenges that we're facing right now. And he spoke a little bit about DUGs, which isn't a term that I had heard before, but it you know, really speaks to me, because as we go through this, that is in many ways the audience and the important people that we need to make sure that we keep in mind as we start to incorporate very sophisticated analyses, like those are capable of being done with software like PowerSim and other deep analytics that we do. We have to make sure that we don't lose sight of the very kind of fundamental nature of our job, which is reliability of the grid and you know, providing that utility kind of service to our customers, where they are very focused on price stability, on reliability, and keeping in mind that, you know, we're dealing with energy commissions and with the populace that are very interested in these topics and who may not be able to approach things with the same level of sophistication that we always have. And so it's incumbent on us to do the work in the right way with all the correct economic kind of sophistication, but then be able to bring it back down for our leadership, as well as commissions, regulators, and the general populace, to be able to present in a way that is meaningful to them, so that as we, you know, try to march down the road of correct economic decision making, we're not leading, you know, leaving all of our constituents in our wake. So talk a little bit about Duke Energy first. We've been around for a long time, and we've got about 24 million people who get their power from us. We are very much focused on our regulated utilities. We've divested the majority of our unregulated assets, which included Duke Energy Ohio's generation assets. We still have Duke Energy Ohio as a transmission company, and we have some position in OVEC there, but we've gotten rid of our assets there. We've gotten rid of our assets in South America, which were fairly extensive, to really focus on our core regulated businesses, as well as our kind of pure Duke Energy Renewables, which is out there doing, you know, wind and solar development. And as you can see here, our mix is very traditional in a lot of ways, 40-40 gas and coal, 20% nuclear, hydro and renewables in there as well. A lot of that is pumped storage, though, which is a little different. And you can see here we're in quite a few different states. And the important thing about this map to me is you'll see that we operate in MISO for our Indiana territory, PJM for our Duke Energy Kentucky, and then the Carolinas and Duke Energy Florida are vertically integrated utilities, which are very different than utilities that sit within an ISO. And We are the balancing authority. We're actually two balancing authorities in the Carolinas, so we have that kind of responsibility as well. And on our renewable side, they've got about 3 gigawatts going on. I did skip the part, so altogether, yeah, there's about 50 gigawatts that we're modeling. So in modeling space, just the sheer size of our assets can make things challenging, make models take a long run to time and long time to run, and just make you know, data validation and all the post processing fairly difficult. But I want to talk about production cost modeling, because it's the basis for a lot of the analysis that's done, whether it's for IRP filings, for fuel cost filings, for analysis for M&A, or for you know, putting out your fuel requirement or your power position. It all goes back to production cost modeling for most utilities, which for those that are unfamiliar, it's an hour by hour typically simulation of every power plant and what its output is going to be like as it, you know, tries to meet load. But it's old, right? It's technology. It's a technique that's been around for a long time, and you know, its primary focus is on unit commitment. You know, that's really the engine behind most of the production cost models, is really about unit commitment and kind kind of being able to put together a one-week schedule of how to most efficiently commit and then dispatch units to meet your native load over, you know, a seven-day time frame when you have actual weather, you know, to make your load forecast of off of. You're not really dealing with price uncertainty because you know what you, you know, you've got for your coal costs and you've got your gas week prices and all that good stuff. And so that production cost model that we use as kind of the basic engine for a lot of the analyses that we do was originally built for something pretty different. And it does some things that that work just fine most of the time, but it has a couple of these underlying kind of its underlying nature and some of its features we'll see make it difficult when you try to apply it in different situations. And it's I was speaking to folks earlier today, and it's not a matter of I have a hammer and so I'm going to pretend everything is a nail. It's a matter of I know that's not a nail, but I only have this hammer, and so that's what I'm going to use. So what are some of the modeling limitations that show up there for most of them? Again, there's lots of different people working on software all the time and a lot of people trying to overcome these challenges, but these are the ones that you're typically going to see and will play into difficulties, especially around renewables. And so they're deterministic for the most part, and that's where they all started, right? And so that means they go down one path. And there's not a probabilistic distribution of outcomes. A lot of the production cost models out there will have kind of a stochastic distribution of outages, but typically the majority of, not just the majority, the vast majority of all the inputs are going to be deterministic in nature. The load, the commodity pricing, all of the fixed forwards that you might have in there for your solar assets. So those things are going to be deterministic, so you're just going to get one outcome. So what does that mean? Well, if you're only going to have one outcome and you're not going to be probable, it's not going to be probabilistic, that, you know, we always do this model validation process, right? When we institute a new model and we get it up and running and we have it working for, you know, our bosses, whether they're focused on fuel procurement or power trading or IRP filings or whatever else, they're going to have a focus in mind. And there's going to be a Doug aspect to it, right, which is the typically what you're going to want to see out of them is something that is familiar, right, and something that is useful for what you are trying to do. And so if it's mostly used for unit commitment, that's where the focus is going to be. You're going to want something that is reliable for unit commitment. So how much do you care about the tail risks? Not that much, right, because you're really looking at something that's going to be good for your day-to-day operations, that you can rely on for your fuel. You can kind of know how many million tons of coal you're going to need, what your daily gas kind of consumption is going to look like. And so you're going to tune the model to work for that. And so what does that mean for something, for a distribution that maybe has really fat tail risks? Well, those fat tail risks would bring up the mean, right? But they're not necessarily going to bring up the mode or the median. So if you're using something for operational purposes, you're probably going to ignore the impacts of those fat tails, because what you're after is really the most likely outcome, not a weighted average of all the potential outcomes, because that's not how you can do operations. It's really good for a financial model. It's not helpful for an operational model. So if you have something that's tuned to be an operational model and not necessarily a financial model, it's going to understate what potentially some of the tail risks are. And we'll see that the renewables really show up there. It's weather normal, right? You always have to have normalized weather in there because you only have one deterministic load forecast, so it's based on normalized weather. And that means it's not going to be able to express the amount of variability that would really happen in weather. You only have 365 days in a given year, so if an event is something that happens, you know, less than one out of 365, the amount of times it's going to show up in there is zero, right? So it's not going to be able to express all the variability that you might see in the weather. And for the most part, when you're trying to figure out fuel procurement or you're trying to look at an entire aggregate fuel bill for a state for a three-month period, that's not particularly important. But when you're looking at potentially what the costs of, like, intermittency are, it's very important, or it has the potential to be very important, because it's not the kind of average normal days of weather that are going to be the most problematic ones. It's going to be the dramatic days. And it's particularly going to be when you have big shifts from one spot to another. So it's going to be surprising events. Weather normalization, you know, doesn't allow for those surprising events to be as prevalent as they might. They're understated in there. Perfect foresight is another one that they've always had. If you're trying to figure out the best way to set up your system for the next week, you pretty much have perfect foresight. You pretty much know what's going to happen over the course of the week, or you're very close to what's going to happen. But as you know, we use these in 5-year models or even 20-year, 30-year models. Perfect foresight becomes much more problematic. Honestly, it becomes just as problematic once you're over a couple of months. Because you know what will happen is that the model knows when there's going to be a unit outage, you know, in a month. It knows when there's going to be a big change in load forecast. It knows weeks in ahead when it might have problems running into minimum load issues, right? So it can do all kinds of weird things hours, weeks, and days ahead of time, so that when that challenge occurs, it's actually not challenging at all. But our dispatchers sitting on the floor can't do that. They can't sit there and say, hey, I know Alan's going to be in a forced outage 2 weeks from now, so I want to cycle a CT in 9 hours, then rump out my pump storage in some weird way. It's not going to happen. But the model's doing all this. So what's it doing? It's understating the costs of weird little events, which, again, if you're doing kind of a 20-year total revenue requirement for, you know, justifying the build of a CC, that might not be super important. But when you're trying to get look at, you know, like some of the fine interactions around renewables, it's very problematic. Again, it's the surprise that can be costly when you're talking about challenges around, you know, maintaining the grid, and you're talking about challenges of intra-hour intermittency. So having that perfect foresight in there, again, is going to underrepresent some of the costs associated with outages and with ancillary services in particular, making sure that, you know, you have, when you run into those min issues, you still have kind of ramp down available and all that stuff. The cost of maintaining those ancillaries during periods of kind of shock or surprise is more expensive. So again, those costs will get underrepresented if you have a kind of that single pass deterministic model with perfect foresight. And so, and the last one here is the granularity, which is hourly time resources. So again, most of these production cost models are hourly. That's just the kind of unit of time that they use. And coal, nuclear, doesn't matter. Hourly is perfectly fine. But for what we're facing now with renewables that have this intermittency, whether it's because of cloud patterns or anything else, it's important. And again, for batteries, super important. Some of the most efficient batteries or some of the best looking batteries for us are 30-minute batteries. 30-minute battery, hourly model, problematic, right? It's just not going to work out perfectly. And then, you know, going back to the, you know, having the size of systems that we do and that a lot of you do, one of the problems in a production cost model is, you know, it has an error into it, right? It doesn't try to solve for the exact perfect answer. It tries to solve for an acceptable answer within, you know, 2% or 3% margin of error, whatever else. So you start to get some of these assets that are small enough, they're inside the margin of error, that can make them obviously very difficult to measure. So that's a bunch of challenges to get over. And so one of the things that we're, you know, looking at is when you're trying to figure out how to do the avoided cost of something, you say, ah, it's just a differential revenue requirement, right? That's how you figure out the value of an asset, whether it's solar or combined cycle or anything else. So you simply say, you know, what is the revenue requirement with and without this asset? When we add this in, what kind of value do we get out of it? So if we take all this, you know, a big block of energy and we stick it in our model and we say that it's solar, and we put zero cost on it, whatever the difference, you know, we just do a delta analysis with and without that, and the difference is the avoided cost, right? Well, probably not. it's we have all kinds of problems over here, you know, risk adjusted, what time frame, under what circumstances. The cost of the solar is going to be one of the things that is masked very well by some of the problems that we looked at here. So I'm going to circle back to that question of why these make that question difficult, and then talk about some of the answers or some of the potential answers that there are to it. So I want to go back to what I spoke to before about the difference between being in an ISO versus being in a vertically integrated utility. So, you know, again, Duke Energy is the balancing authority in the Carolinas, which means there is no market for ancillary services. You can't buy or sell reg or spin or anything like that. So Duke is the BA. So when you're thinking about these ancillary services, say like reg down or spinning reserves or whatever else, if you have kind of a but-for analysis, you say, hey, in this world, we need more ancillaries than we did in this world, even if we have a similar load. The costs can manifest either as capital costs, right? You could build in, more spinning reserves to your system by having, you could do all kinds of things from, you know, increase or lowering the mins on your combined cycles, you know, through a capital cost, or you could do things like putting in different batteries. You have lots of options. But my group does kind of that five-year analysis, right? And so the work that we do is in kind of more of a static system, typically. And so when you have one set of kind of steel in the ground and you want to increase your ancillary requirements, the way that you see those costs are through energy costs, right? They manifest themselves as energy costs. So if you want to, for example, increase your spinning reserves, you might ramp a unit down 50 megawatts from its max load, right? So it can sit there and provide spin or reg up. But its heat rate's going to degrade a little bit, right? It's going to sit there, down there, at a lower average heat rate. And so the average dollar per megawatt hour cost of your unit, of your system, is going to go up. Same thing, you know, if you're running into minimum load issues, but you still got to provide reg down, you could cycle a combined cycle unit between a 2-in-1 and a 1-by-1. So all these things that you're going to do to provide more ancillary services in a given system are going to manifest as energy costs. And so when you talk about replacing a block of energy and doing a differential revenue requirement analysis and you swap those things in there, you're going to see a difference in energy costs. And some of that's going to be associated with, you're going to see the cost of the energy go away, right? But not all of it. Some of it's going to come back in the form of ancillary services that are imposed upon the system by the addition of the intermittent resources that behave differently by whatever they were replacing. And so the nature of those costs are some of the nature of how solar adds costs are its sub-hourly volatility, right? By having sub-hourly volatility, it means you have to have something follow it or balance it, right? And so that balance could be provided by maybe a CT ramping up and down, right? But if the CT is moving up and down all the time, it's going to have heat rate degradation. It's going to have a higher average cost per megawatt hour. The sub-hourly volatility also means you're going to have to increase your reserve requirements just from a day-ahead point of view. You can capture that in a normal analysis. Operational uncertainty, that's pretty straightforward. It's just going to add uncertainty to your net load, essentially. Cost driven by weather and volatility, talked about that a little bit. Obviously, the kind of cloudier a given day is, or the more that you have disruptions of the solar through cloud cover, those are going to drive a cost there as you have to follow it. The more volatile it is, the more costs are going to be associated with it. Important to remember, solar can provide value here too, right? If you have curtailable solar, it can provide reg up when it's being curtailed, or it can provide reg down when it's not. And costs driven by gas price and stack slope. So this part's important too. Solar costs are very often driven by gas price. Solar integration costs are very often driven by gas prices because they manifest as energy costs, right? And energy costs are driven by gas prices. So if you're in a situation where gas is really, really cheap and you have heat rate degradation on a CC, it's not as impactful as if you're sitting around $8 gas, right? It's going to be winnier, essentially. And stack slope. Stack slope is a big one. If you have lots of resources that are all very similar in pricing, you have a lot of ability to move those up and down and move energy from one to another without too much cost. But if you have a really steep slope in your stack and you have resources that are very differently priced, so say you're moving from nuclear into maybe some older coal units and then perhaps into maybe old oil diesel generators or something like that, you have this crazy stack slope. As you start to add these costs, they're much more expensive than if you had a nice flat stack. Because when you start to have to think about cycling units, or you think about having to provide spinning reserves with units that really weren't meant for it, your stack is really important. So what does this mean for us? I want to jump over to our bill here, House Bill 589. We have a new House bill, North Carolina House Bill 589, which is going to, it's basically a reinterpretation of PURPA in North Carolina, and it's going to allow us to do RFPs for competitive bidding of solar into the Duke Energy. And it's a good bill for us, and it's a good bill for development of solar in the state, because it's essentially going to require us to sign up solar PPAs for 10 years. But it's going to give us some control over siting and location, which is huge for us. Because right now, most of our solar is landing on the Duke Energy Progress side rather than Duke Energy Carolina side. And we have a JDA, we have a joint dispatch agreement between those two BAs, and we're able to move power between one and the other. If it wasn't for that, it would be very difficult to even solve Duke Energy Progress with the amount of solar that it has on its system right now. It just has too many minimums issue. Fortunately, we're able to push that energy across over into Duke Energy Carolinas. But having control over some of the siting in the future will help us make sure that that it's economic, because obviously, if you can't solve, we're in that situation where power is below zero, right? It's worth less than nothing. All it's doing is forcing you to send it across, or if you try to keep it on, you won't even be able to solve your commitment question. That's obviously not the most valuable place to have it. So this bill will allow us to be able to get some control over siting, and equally as important, will allow for curtailability. So curtailability is a pretty big game changer when it comes to solar. Most of the deals that we had in the past were totally non-curtailable or under some very kind of onerous conditions. And so what that means is it's a must-take resource, right? And so that's why it presents the challenges around things like the duck curve, right, that we've talked about, and presents challenges in other ways. So adding curtailability in there makes the resource much more flexible, which will reduce the integration costs of it, but obviously adds some risk on the other side. So what are the make-whole provisions? We've talked about things like 5% free curtailability, and after that it's take or pay. There's still room to figure out, but even just a little bit of curtailability can make, based on the studies that we've done, can make the integration much less painful for when it comes to balancing the grid. But in order for these people to do the RFP with us, so it's competitive, so lowest price will win, but in addition to that, it also has to come in below the avoided cost that we're going to produce for it. So we're going to essentially say, a vintage, 2019 50 megawatt block will have to be below such and such a price to kind of clear it, and it's going to be our avoided cost. And so if you think about what we're doing here, we want to come up with the price for that solar energy, right, to come onto the system. But we want to, we're going to do it in an avoided cost style, right? We want to make sure it's economic, though. We want to make sure that it's being priced correctly. And so if we use that kind of traditional approach where we use our hourly, weather normal, deterministic model with perfect foresight, and we do an avoided cost by using a differential revenue requirement, we're going to overvalue the solar because we're going to undervalue the ancillary costs associated with the integration of it, because we're not going to see the costs that only manifest themselves based on the kind of surprise of how the real-time load could come in differently from the day-ahead load. And we're not going to see what can happen on the tail risks of load on a given day, because we only have a deterministic load forecast. And we wouldn't see the costs of a CPS2 violation for only a 5-minute interval, because we're only looking at things hourly, right? So all of these things are gaps that exist because of the nature of a tool that's being used for decades and was originally purposed for something very different. So we've got this challenge, and it's not entirely dissimilar from a challenge that we had faced a few years back, which was just as that we had a lot of solar coming onto our grid, and we had a kind of a typical avoided cost filing. I think it was in 2014. Yeah. So we worked with PNNL, Pacific Northwest National Laboratory, as part of the DOE, and we worked with them on some software called ECOS to do a sub-hourly modeling exercise and look at some of the costs. You can see here how some of the costs were broken down. So fuel efficiency loss, talked a little bit about that, from carrying additional reserves or more startups from cycling, quantified through production cost modeling. Over here, you can see we captured some other types of costs. This study actually even went into a little bit of distribution costs. But the point here is we've had some experience with it, and this is something we did where what we essentially did was layered in some of the solar-shaped energy to replace traditional energy that was already in there, and look at the difference in costs associated with having, instead of a flat shape that you might see, or more of a load, not flat, but a load-following shape that you would see from a traditional fossil resource, put in a solar kind of production shape. And we looked at things like increased reserve requirements that would be associated with those penetration levels. And we did some cost analysis of what the different blocks would look like. We can't take, and this is just some for kind of to demonstrate it, some of the costs that were associated with it. You could see coming in here to the tune of anywhere between $2 and upwards of $10 a megawatt hour, just depending on how soon it was and how much the penetration levels were. And when we kind of graphed it over here, you could see it a little bit. I think this one makes a little bit more sense, as basically the percentage of the portfolio goes up, the cost associated with it goes up in a non-linear way, right? It goes up in a sloping way, to say that the more and more of the intermittent resource you add, the more and more cost it has per unit, because its effects are compounding upon themselves. But this, what we're looking at now is very different, because this was non-curtailable. This was non-curtailable. And so these costs are very high. With curtailable solar, I don't expect the cost of integration to be nearly as high, because if you don't want to cycle a unit, you don't have to, right? You can just not take the solar instead. But there will be instances where you say, you know what? Even though taking the solar is going to force me to curtail this, I'm going to take it anyway. And so you still will have costs. It's just a question of how much. So what we're going to do, one of the challenges that we, again, comes back to this, the idea of the dealing with utility guys, is we want to make sure that our starting point is a traditional avoided cost methodology, even with all of its foibles. Because we want to make sure that the analysis is understandable, that it is relatable to the people who have been through these kinds of filings before, and understand kind of the background of how these analyses are done, so that we're not trying to come completely out of left field, and so people think we're not trying to pull the wool over their eyes or anything like that. But we have to make sure that we capture a couple of these things. So that means we're going to add complexity, and we're going to do it by partnering with Ascend. And what we're partnering with them for is on PowerSim to be able to do sub-hourly modeling where we analyze NERC standards at the 5 minute or one minute level. We will use a two-pass approach where we force the units to do a commitment schedule based on essentially a day ahead or a week ahead load forecast, and then do the dispatch based on real-time load forecast that has an appropriate statistical deviation from the load forecast associated with the commitment. We're going to incorporate spatial diversity so that the geographical locations of the solar sites are taken into account when we consider the cost that they add, because the geographic location determines the amount of correlation between the output of the sites, and that correlation is going to determine whether or not the overall volatility of the solar generation. If all the sites are highly correlated with one another, you'll get very big swings, right? They become additive. So if you have two sites that are perfectly correlated, you have twice as much volatility than if you just had the one site. But if you have sites that are negatively correlated, they interfere with one another, and so your total variability goes down, which means your integration costs are going to go down. So this is valuable not just for helping choose which applicants might be the most economic, but it's also good for developing your own siting of where you want to be if you are the one who is providing the energy for your ratepayers. You can decrease those costs just by making sure you've got the right kind of geographical distribution. And very importantly, we want to use stochastic load, weather, and commodity prices to reflect the tail risks and the cost of volatility. So we want to make sure that that load volatility is in there, because that's where a lot of these prices are going to express themselves. And the other thing is, the gas volatility goes both ways, right? A lot of long-term forecasts use fundamental gas prices that are quite a bit higher than market, and those could over-represent the cost of integrating solar. So it's not a matter of just showing where solar is more expensive. It's a matter of showing where it's less expensive, too, because the goal is just to get it right. It's not to try to encourage it. It's not to try to discourage it. It's just to make sure that it's cost out correctly. We think that this work is going to help us make this bill work out really well, so that we can be confident that when we're accepting these solar bids, that they actually are economic for our ratepayers, right? We talked about, Mark mentioned some of the, average incomes of, people in the U.S. Our rate base is considerably below that. We have quite a bit of low-income geographic area within our territory, and so price sensitivity is very high for us. And so, we want to make sure that if we are accepting these bids for solar generation, that they are indeed economic, and that means making sure we price it out correctly. And that means acknowledging that some of the technology that we have is flawed or behind the times, and partnering with companies like Ascend or whomever to try to get it right. And I think right now we're going down a really good path with PowerSim to be able to address each and every one of these. And at the end of the day, we're going to go for what we always go for, which is kind of our DART philosophy, which is defendable, auditable, repeatable, and transparent. And those to us are the signatures of good analysis. And so we want this to be very robust, because it's going to be challenging. The kind of issues that are at hand here are somewhat complicated, and our audience is really different in terms of their level of sophistication. It can run the complete gamut. So we want to make sure that it's robust and explainable. And typically, I love the saying that if someone can't explain something to you simply, it's because they don't understand it well enough. So, questions? Or am I already eating into break time? I don't know. I haven't looked at the clock. Gary?
I
Sure. Yeah, so what it comes down to in solar is the HB 589 also addressed a lot of the capacity issues. Those are done in a different shop than mine, so it's not my area of expertise. But one of the primary problems was the capacity rates given to solar under some of the PURPA when it just didn't have any capacity value at all. You know, we have kind of shifted from summer peaking to winter peaking, you know, and the way that our load comes in, a lot of, you know, new solar addition just doesn't add any functional capacity to our system. So when we're giving capacity payments to these people for that kind of incremental capacity that doesn't actually add any value, it's, you know, it's basically just taking our ratepayers' money and giving it away, which is not what we want to do. And as far as on the energy side, the biggest problem was having it show up on the wrong side of the Carolinas for us, so showing up in Duke Energy Progress rather than Duke Energy Carolinas. And just the, I mean, the reality is if it wasn't for the fact that the systems were merged and the two BAs operate across a joint dispatch agreement, they would be dumping energy left and right. Yes? So it's just put to us, essentially.
So a developer just builds a solar farm and says, hey, you've got to buy it?
Yes.
And how do you price that?
With our avoided cost filing, which is based on essentially that differential revenue requirement as well as a capacity component. And both of those costs or values are essentially overstated. And that's why we were getting so much put to us, right, is because we're paying them far more than what they're worth. So everyone was like, yes, me too. Anything else? Yes?
So one more follow on to that then is what's the expectation over time that you're now paying more of a market rate rather than a high rate?
Well, we're confident that solar penetration is going to continue at a pretty good clip. Except for we're hoping to get it in the right spot. And one of the other things I failed to mention is very important is that under HB 589, Duke Energy itself is allowed to bid. So we will be part of the competitive bidding process. There's a lot of hair on that, obviously, and the laws and development, but it also opens up the possibility for us to be the provider of that solar energy. Yes?
Matt, do you see more value for solar in DEC versus DEP, just given how much is already in DEP?
Yes, absolutely. There's certainly value for solar in DEC, even with what's in DEP. I think getting some geographical diversity will help us out a lot. But it's just a matter of cost, right? That's the hope. If we do this right, and we come up with a correct avoided cost, any bid that wins is a good deal for our ratepayer. That's the way we want to do it. So if we can get the modeling right, and someone can beat that price, then absolutely.
Another question.
Sure.
So you mentioned solar, that you know, with your system being winter peaking now,
mm-hmm.
capacity value of solar is almost zero.
Can be. Yeah, so we actually have pretty much some of the best storage in the world, I would say. We have Bad Creek and Jocassee pump storage, right? So I can't remember the exact capacities on them, but it's well over 1,000 megawatts. And they can turn on a dime, right, to pump or to gen. And that is why DEC is able to take on all of that solar from DEP, is that the pump storage can manage it so easily, or much more easily than most systems have, because we can literally do a 3,000 megawatt swing in like 30 seconds, right? So we can deal with that kind of intermittency. But those pumps, Bad Creek and Jocassee, they already provide a lot of value, right? They already provide a ton of value in terms of ancillary services, in terms of price shifting, cycling, avoiding. So they're, I won't say they're, you know, fully utilized. They can, there are probably situations that they can provide more value than they already are. But we have some pretty great storage, and it's serving that purpose, but it also has the ability to serve other purposes. Anything else? All right, well, thanks a lot. Appreciate it.